According to the clock. Okay. 6:34 PM. So there's a public comment, and we'd like the public comment just to be about the selection of the independent investigator, individual or firm. Start with Amy. Sure.
Okay. Amy Listinski at 140 High Road. Just a couple things I wanted to make mention of. I just wanted to publicly thank Bob and Gina for the extra time they're putting in for this effort. This is above and beyond, I think, what you guys originally signed on for when you were elected into office. You have families at home, so I know all the families in town appreciate the hard work and extra time you're putting in. I think sometimes people don't understand that how town government works. You guys cannot make these decisions without being in the public. Things take time. And we're finally here. And this is an ongoing thing. And for those people out there that have said we moved on, I have not moved on. I also want to bring to light, I know that the last time we were here, like part two of this whole finding a firm, Vin Marino, our town attorney, was here and had just made some suggestions on how he was going to get some of the packets out to firms that he knew. And while that's wonderful and appreciate the help, I would just like you guys to take into consideration any firms that he may know. I don't feel we're going to get the most unbiased opinion from them. So I'm hoping that there are plenty to pick from. There's a plethora of good ones, my hope is, and we can find one that's going to be as fair as possible to the town. And then lastly, I know that once the documentation's opened, it's public information. So I just want to throw out there that I'm hoping at some point residents, whether it's us here tonight or anybody in the town, can have access to see the documents that were presented, just so we can kind of read up, especially on the firm that's chosen. Thank you.
Yeah, just before I go on, I imagine it's possible that it could be scanned and put on the website for people.
Okay.
And you had a concern that it was only town attorneys. The town attorney did identify a number of firms, and they were sent letters. Gina and I had also brought some other names. And some of them were duplicates. And it was also publicly advertised. I think just in the register, right?
Yeah, and a whole website, but you'd have to know what was there. So I think it was
Jamie,
in the
I think you were next.
Well, can I just say I want to say to thank you, Amy, for saying that. I appreciate it. And I do, just before I forget, that we did get a response from a firm that I think Vin, I think it was a duplicate. I think I also thought it was a good idea to reach out to Shipman and Goodwin. And that firm declined to submit a proposal because of the conflict that they have, since they represent the Board of Education. And I think, they're a great firm. They're a reputable firm. I was sort of, sad to see that they were not going to be in the mix, but also understand that they're correct, that there is a conflict that is very clear. And I'm glad that they recognize what a conflict of interest is, and that they made the right decision there. So I just wanted people to know that they were on my list. They were, I believe, on Ben's list, and probably yours as well, and that they will not be in the mix. And I think, as far as your question about having access to these documents, I mean, I'm in favor of full transparency. I think if people want to wait, I'd be happy to go make copies today if anyone's interested.
Okay. Thank you both.
I do think that posting them, scanning them and posting them is also a really good idea. For people who aren't here or people who are online.
Jamie, it's your turn.
Thank you. Jamie Sterling, 20 Miller Road. I also want to thank you both for serving. Sometimes you're called to do exceptional things, and this may be one of them. And to the point that I've heard recently in various meetings that it's time to move on, I think it's history tells us that unless we find out where we've been, it's impossible to move forward effectively. And Kathleen Schulman's requirement that we do an investigation was a good one to bring this forward. I've read through the request for proposal and you'll be considering in the items in the scope of work, and I just want to make a couple of comments to hope that you would use your judgment and bend a little bit from this original scope of work. And my comments are that in the second paragraph on page 2, the following describes in general the anticipated scope of work and is meant to limit, not meant to limit the investigation as it may develop. I would like to suggest that you kind of be thinking of or limit the choice of the investigator, because the scope of work is very specific, And having responded to multiple RFPs in my 10 years as a businessman, I know that they can be crafted to direct the answers to a very specific set of attorneys or people who respond. In the final report at the bottom of page 2, where it says draft a comprehensive, I'd like you to think in terms of prepare a comprehensive, because the draft is something that was addressed before, about a draft being going forward to the Board of Selectmen, who then would have an opportunity to maybe edit it. And I think preparing and then sending directly to the town is the key. On page 4, where the letter of interest evaluation, it reads, the investigator must have experience. Must have experience limits your scope dramatically. If it were to read instead, the investigator with experience.
Jamie, can you repeat where you're looking, what you're looking at?
Oh, yeah, sorry. Page 4 under 6A.
Okay.
It says the investigator must have experience. If it read instead, and I would suggest that in your deliberations you kind of lean toward, the investigator with experience in similar investigation reviews will be given preference rather than must have. And the next section about preferred experience seems to me to be too restrictive. We may get the right person for Bethany to investigate this without it being should have experience in all these areas. You may find the right person without that. Finally, on page 5, item E, insurance. While this is very specific and is incorporated in almost every contract, it seems excessive to me for the scope of this work. Unless we're trying to protect the identities of people in town, and we may be able to do that with the draft of the report. Instead, I would say in your negotiations, rather than adhering so strictly to these limits of $5 million for each occurrence, $100,000 for these occurrences, you would limit it, or you can at least lower it. Thank you.
Can we mute them? Mm-hmm. Is it possible?
Thank you.
Thank you. Also like to go ahead.
Can I just respond to Jen? Mm-hmm. Thank you for your comments. I did want you to know that where it says final report, we, I think, publicly have talked about the fact that we as a board are not, Bob and I are not going to request any edits. It will be a report that goes directly to the public. We're not going to change. We're not going to request change. You know, we've talked about that, and that's what I believe was decided at a town meeting, and so we're not going to violate that. But thank you for bringing it up. It's a good reminder. And as far as the insurance, you know, to be honest, you know, drafting something like this when it's not something you do every day is difficult, right? I mean, all of the components, all of the parts that go into it, and we did copy and paste the language that the town uses in their other in the documents, another, I think, RFPs, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it was just that they used to hire the town auditor.
You know, and I do, I think that I hear what you're saying. You want us to be flexible, and I think people are going to be open-minded and flexible. I think, though, also that a person who wants to put in, you know, a letter of intent has the option of building that into the, you know, the cost section, the payment section. But I hear you. Thank you.
Sorry, it's your turn.
Amy Rosenstein, 31. With tonight's special meeting, I just wanted to ask the two selectmen, Bob and Gina, for overtaking and following. In the letter of interest post, the third item focuses on scope. It highlights a thorough, impartial, and systematic investigation. In doing this, the residents of town would like whatever firms or independent investigators that have applied that can take into consideration whether they are known affiliates or are recommended by our town attorney, DeMarino. As we've seen throughout these months, he's acting in the best interest of Selectwoman, not necessarily the town as a whole. Using someone he recommends could interfere with the investigation, and their findings could be biased. Also, many people within our town community are unclear why this has taken so long to get to the point that we're at, and they're unaware of the process of how it works amongst the selectmen as a whole. For example, the two of you are not allowed to meet to discuss or plan this without notifying the town and having the discussions in public for us to listen to. Please correct us if we're wrong in that. And the internal investigators will hold no subpoena powers. So if an employee, present or former, or perhaps the first Selectman who is being advised by a town attorney chooses not to speak or answer questions, they're under no legal obligation to answer. So it's possible that this could actually uncover nothing in the end. Again, it's practice, that's all.
I don't think nothing. I wouldn't go quite that far. But it's true that the, as far as I know, the investigator is not going to have subpoena power. And so that could have create some limitations, but I'm more optimistic than that. I think that there are other aspects to an investigation that go beyond interviews, and so I'm hopeful that there will be something that we get out of this. I mean, we're certainly as a town putting a lot of effort into this, and I'm hopeful that we'll get, you know, some answers. As far as, you know, can the investigator force someone to speak? I don't think so. I could be wrong. You know, I'd be happy to be wrong about that.
But you two can't meet without to discuss this.
That's correct. Yeah, it'd be a violation of freedom.
No, it would be good if it would be done already.
Right. Yeah.
Get together on a Saturday.
Yes.
So just so people can have a concept of how it works, if we meet and talk about this, or talk about anything that could be on an agenda, we are having a meeting that wasn't noticed to the town, who has a right to be present. And so there's that violation of that open records, open meetings law. And so it's complicated when you have two people. It's not a violation if we say, hello, how are you? Or if we're talking about maybe scheduling. But if you talk about anything at all of substance, then it's a violation. So it's difficult, and I think that has been part of the delay. So, you know, I'm grateful that you brought that up. I think we've tried as to schedule meetings quickly and not wait until the regularly scheduled meeting to do this, so that we can move things forward as often as we could. We haven't met for a few weeks because we wanted to give potential responders to this an opportunity to write up their proposal and send it to us, but. I think before this, we were meeting more frequently.
There was a faster process that was proposed, but we decided to go with the public advertising and stuff. The town attorney, for other matters, would have, you know, selected another firm to do it. And they could have gotten started on it right away as soon as there was funding. But there was concern that maybe the results then wouldn't be believed by anybody, by everyone. So this is... It takes more time, but hopefully more people will have confidence in the results. Would anyone else like to comment in the room? Seeing none, anybody online that wants to comment?
Somebody
all right, yeah, please raise your hand because I think we're all muted.
All right, I'm going to mute it. Oh. Chatting. But they can just unmute themselves if they want to.
So okay. I'm told you can unmute yourself if you want to speak. All right, hearing none, we'll move to.
Yes. Question. Amy Rushlow, 34 Northrop Road Extension. Obviously, there's also the other investigation with the state's child advocacy, which has subpoena power to further their investigation. So I'm assuming, and so I want to put it out there, because I don't want to assume that they will share these findings with them in case there's anything else that might need to be done or further investigated.
I don't know.
Amy, that's a great point. The Office of the Child Advocate does have subpoena power. So hopefully with the two, you know, we'll get more answers. Well, did you have another question?
No, I know how this takes in this town, so I'm assuming that the state soon, again, don't want to do that, but that their investigation might be completed further than ours, or come to some type of information. So just want to make sure that we're sharing information either way with whatever their report finds, and whatever our report finds.
Sharing information with who?
The investigator.
The investigation, like whatever the state uncovers with the investigation is shared with town and our investigator so that they...
Well, the Office of Child Advocacy, when they work on investigations like this, they usually issue a public report. So I don't, you know, I mean, I can't force them to, I think we'll all see the report probably at the same time. I'm not sure what their timeframes is. In full disclosure, my office sometimes works on investigations with them, and I know them to be very thorough and really great investigators. So I'm glad they have subpoena power, and I'm hopeful.
Mr. Selectman, it's the town attorney. By statute, the investigation of the OCA is confidential. So it's not until they issue their public statement does what they want to put into the public become public. So it's doubtful that there would be a sharing or an exchange of information because of the confidentiality of the OCA's investigation.
Right, prior to the report coming out. I think that's right. That's fine.
All right. So we're going to... Sure, sir.
Not to...
Can you say your name?
Connie Royster, Fairwood Road. Not to disagree with my distinguished colleague here, Jamie Sterling. However, I got the end of what he was saying. I do disagree with him that the choice should be someone who has experience in this area. I think that's important, and we shouldn't be considering anybody who doesn't have experience investigating matters of this type.
Thank you.
It's pretty broad, but I think it should be seriously part of our choices.
Thank you.
Jackie Nugent. Hi, this is actually Jillian Nugent, 53 Miller Road. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you guys? Okay, awesome. I just wanted to speak to something that was being discussed a minute ago about the investigation that's being done by the Office of the Child Advocate. And it's that they're not necessarily, though they do have subpoena power, they're not necessarily looking at the same piece of this as we are. And they're not looking at, as far as I understand it, the 18-month time period that we're really wondering what happened. They're looking at what happened that allowed this to happen, if that makes sense. So their scope is definitely different than the scope of this investigation. And I feel like that's an important thing to keep in mind.
Thank you. I think that's a good point. And that's part of the reason why the town moved to have its own, its own investigation, is that the Office of Child Advocate wasn't looking at some of the things that people in town wanted to be addressed. So that's a good point. Thanks for the reminder. That's a good point.
All right. There were five responses submitted by mail, and the town clerk's office made a list. I'll just read off the names. We're going to Jay Pitney, Spears Manning, Weishaupt Log Group, Brosnan, nothing else, Pullman and Conley. And then I think one of the first things we should talk about is there was one firm that submitted by email to the town attorney, who then forwarded it to us. The email was sent to the town attorney at 1:57 p.m., just before the deadline. I checked our request for letter of interest language, because there was a draft where everything was going to be PDFs emailed to Jen Capasso. That got changed to everything had to be mailed to the town hall. But I think in the final, page 3, section 4, the final version of it just says, responses will be received by the Town of Bethany Board of Selectmen until 2 p.m. Monday, September 23rd, and then solicitation. So it ended up not having a specific method. So I think we should consider it, since it came in and we hadn't prohibited that method, although we had earlier talked about.
Yeah, that's right. We did talk about that other...
Different method
that we ended up changing, and that's probably why it was in my head, like, oh, why did they email it to us? But it says received by this date, and it was received by this date, so I think we should consider it as well.
Okay, so they'll be added, and that one is from.
May I ask you a question?
Yeah.
was that sent to the select you two, or was it sent to the attorney?
Our emails were not public, so I think people wouldn't have a way of knowing. I don't know why they're not on the town website. I think it would be, I think people have requested emails, and it's sometimes hard to find our emails, and I would, if I had power, I would do that, because it's very easy to do that. But this happens to be from Robinson Cole. It's a very reputable law firm. Many of you have probably heard of them. You know, I think
Robinson
that because there was no violation of the of our rules, I think we should throw them in the mix.
Yeah, just for consideration. All right, so the six firms, Robinson and Cole, and their proposal we already have in PDF format, so that'll be easy to put on the website.
Right.
All right, still open with limits on options. Sure. And then comments. Three copies of proposals, so let me stop looking at all of them myself.
Could I ask a question?
Yes.
Are
collection?
In the selection at all.
Can you repeat that?
Are the town's attorneys participating in the selection of this special?
The people who will be making the final selection are me and Bob.
But are they participating in the review?
No. So, no. This is Bob and I have an obligation to do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they are not providing counsel or advice?
They provide counsel and advice if we ask them for counsel or advice, but I mean I actually was wondering why they were here today. I think this is not a legal matter. We're opening up mail. It's not really I don't think we need two attorneys at a meeting like this. You know.
So we're being charged for this.
That's part of the routine.
Sorry?
It's part of the routine.
So I would guess this is probably about 20, 25 pages long. So okay.
I just wanted
to. I mean, if there were meetings every day for 30 days, it wouldn't affect the routine.
No.
I mean, at some point, there's the retainer, right?
A quick explanation. By retainer, we attend the Board of Selectmen meetings under the retainer. And if the number of meetings become excessive, then we reserve the right to have a discussion with the town about the number of meetings. But since this is a Board of Selectmen meeting, we're here for any reason that you may ask for. And there is no meeting now beyond the retainer.
So this is extra.
This is not extra. This is under the retainer.
He reserves the right to ask
the town.
If there are, right.
But who's the town?
Paula.
So the Board of Finance would be the town.
Paula, it's Paula has absolute authority to hire the town attorney, and so Paula is really the one who would, you know, Paula,
by ordinance, correction, the town attorney is selected by the Board of Selectmen. The recommendation is of the first selection, but the ordinance gives the power to the board, and that the board is who ultimately approved me when I was first appointed.
Okay, so the Board of Selectmen does not have the power to retain the town attorney, okay, because just like we don't have the power to fire the town attorney, okay, and that's my understanding, and if I'm wrong about that, then I will do some research. It's my understanding that Paula has absolute authority to hire the town attorney, and any negotiations between them on in terms of how many meetings they were expected to be present with are conversations that I'm assuming are had with Paula. If I said anything that you disagree with, Bob, I'm happy to.
Well, I think Vin is technically correct, but de facto, it nominated by the first selectman and we approve, but unless they're not licensed attorneys and they don't have any municipal law, we have to approve. So de facto, it's with Paula, but technically it's the board, but we don't really have any discretion.
We don't have any discretion, and that's what I think people are interested in, and not interested in the technicalities. We're really going off on a tangent, but I appreciate the question. I think that other people have asked at other meetings, and it's hard to get information on details like that.
Did you want to go through the proposal, or it's 25 pages long and resumes and everything.
Well, why don't we open them all up to see if there's copies? This one's from Coleman and Conley.
They gave us three copies. But yeah, I could see in our final version, we didn't have a certain number. This one is from Blasen. We probably only submitted one copy. Brosnan Smart Security Solutions. We're in New York.
So, New York? That's interesting.
This is one Pearl River, New York.
Well, where are they?
The town is Pearl River. Ever heard of it?
What's the full name of the person?
The solicitation was addressed to Thomas Murray, Brosnan Risk.
Well, Brosnan Risk Consultants.
Oh, okay.
So it's probably more of a detective. All right, so I think we're going to have to make copies and distribute them and also put them online. Because we only have ones. Next one is from the Weishaupt Law Group. I'm sorry, pronouncing it wrong. Weishaupt, Weishaupt. And they're in Milford. So you've got a cover letter, and then a sealed that's the proposal. So it's not a letter.
Is it just a letter?
We didn't tell them she didn't.
Right,
I know we should have. It's okay. There's more of a letter format, and it presumably addresses the categories. Yeah. T. Christopher Weishaupt.
Yeah. Can I just look at the last page?
This number up is from Spears Manning in Southport, Connecticut.
Can you say that again?
Spears Manning in Southport. Copy again. Spears Manning letter format. Letter format. Okay, 3.5 words. That's bad. last one was from Jay Pitten in Stanford. Just need one copy. It's a very bit of a few pages. The letter and then addressing our letters of intent. So I think we're not doing
it. Did you see the schedule?
Yeah, I mean, we can start going through them and
just take up, like, keep things like
10 to 14. Is there a staff up? Is there more? That's background information.
Mm-hmm.
And then start interviews.
Okay.
Well, that should be interesting. That's on the basis?
Well, the hourly rates are high. So I think when we go through it, we should have like key elements taken out from each one. Like what are they going to charge the town? What do they have experience? What's the schedule? How, you know, can they start immediately?
One factor might be where are the people located that were doing the work, because you'd rather they did in-person interviews instead of online to save traveling. I mean, adds the cost, but you're trying to determine whether somebody's telling the truth and what they can do as well. All right, what would you like to do next? We can start going into them. You want to go through and pull out those hourly rates and schedule things and just talk about them?
I mean, I think it's interesting that it's Brosman, are they lawyers or?
I don't think so, but we can.
Okay, so it looks like we have five law firms and one investigation firm. So that's interesting. And I think it's Brosman, Brosman, I believe if they're in New York, it makes me wonder, do they have staff here or would they be charging us for travel back and forth to New York?
Do you want to adjourn and review, or do you want to just, I'm not saying comprehensive review, I think maybe just go through and talk about what the rates and the general schedule are?
Yeah, that may give us some. I mean, I think we'd have to look at, background. Have they done similar investigations? And,
yeah, I'm not saying this is comprehensive.
So all the objective difference between the cost and travel, like what they're going to charge you for and what they're not going to charge you for, so then you can kind of balance both in the context.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's just kind of
right.
Well, yeah, we'll move there. That's not really the right time.
All right.
So this is the first firm is Pullman Conley. They were talking about. They actually came up with, and we did ask for it, and they came up with an estimate just based on the scope. They can't be held hard to this, because it's going to vary with the interviews, but they think the total cost will be $53,350. And their hourly rates are for partners, $495 an hour, counsel, $400 an hour, associates, $300 per hour, and paralegals are $220 per hour.
And just having reviewed some of these, the $495 an hour for a partner is on the lower side of some of these proposals that we've gotten.
So I'm looking for the schedule. Immediate 60 days, that's phase one. Preliminary consultation, initial data collection. Phase two, 60 to 75 days. I think that means from day 60 to 75, but I'm not sure, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, the way they're writing it next. So 60 days, and then at 75 days, so they have 2 weeks to conduct interviews, outreach to DCF and the state police, phase three, another 15 days, you're up to 100 days now, prepare and edit first draft, review with town attorney. Phase four, another 15 days, you're up to 115 days, you'd expect final report, so about 4 months.
Did you say review with town attorney?
Yes. That's what it says, yeah. I'm just reading what's here. I don't know. I'm just reading what's there. You know, the people who responded to this, all they had was this document, which tried to tell them something about what we're looking for. So, all right. So this one you're looking at, they're saying 115 days is what they anticipate, and $53,350.
How much?
$53,000.
Who was it?
Pullman and Conley, and they are located in Hartford. Yeah. So this address.
Can I just ask, that means that a paralegal would be doing bulk of the work?
It doesn't say. We'd have to go further into
that. They would definitely have paralegals formatting the documents and stuff like that. I mean, I don't know if they're going to send
I didn't read. They actually had anticipated, in front of those hourly rates, 30 partner hours, 40 council hours, 20 associate hours, and 75 paralegal hours.
Thank you.
Let's look at
Interesting with Pullman and Conley, with the they tell you who they would.
I think we asked them to.
Who would be doing the work? So you have one guy, Robert Goldsberg, who's a retired judge. So you know, definitely knows a lot about the legal landscape there. Monty Frank. Who's, I believe, very active in the Connecticut Bar Association. Melinda Kaufman, Melinda Kaufman, one of the attorneys. Kimberly Capella, one of the attorneys. Patricia LaBelle Last, one of the paralegals. And so they gave us their resumes and, information on what other cases that they've worked on. The judge, retired judge, it looks like he's worked on
clerical sexual abuse.
Who's the judge?
Goldsberg.
And I think when we started this and started talking about investigation, I believe we were, anticipating like that it's an important decision for the town. We should, put the time that it takes to sort of figure out like who's the best option for Bethany. And, so I just thought about like under his profile, it says that he led an investigation on behalf of one of Connecticut's largest municipalities. And I just wonder, like, it'd be interesting to look at that report as an example of something we might get. So that's why I think, it'd be almost impossible to make a decision today, because I think we have to kind of do the homework. Do you agree, Bob? Like, something like that might be interesting?
Yes, I don't know. It might depend on confidential report, so you don't get a copy unless the client releases it, which they probably won't.
I think it'd be interesting, how did it turn out? Was the report call the town? Were they happy with the work that these lawyers did? I mean, that would be interesting information for us, I think.
That's true.
See
if they provided reference.
Right. I mean, something like that. So I think I'm really interested if I see anything in any of these documents about any of these lawyers or investigators actually representing towns with some issue that needs to be investigated. What was the outcome? Was the town happy with what they paid for? Because it's not inexpensive. So I think it would be great to get feedback like that. I mean, you could call them and they could say, don't hire them unless you're crazy, right? I mean, who knows? I'm just using that as an example. I think these firms, they all seem, certainly Pullman and Conley, who I happen to be looking at right now, is a very reputable firm. I just think that's the sort of thing I'm thinking about when I think about how do you make a decision like this. You don't put the six names in a
in a bag and pull one out, right?
Right.
So that's sort of the kind of information I'm thinking about having, if I can get it, that would be useful in terms of making a decision.
All right, so pretty thick, I don't know, what are these thick from David? So looking for the same in general information again. Looks like they're responding to each part of that request for proposal. Staff plan.
Interestingly, it seems like there's kind of a theme where a lot of the firms are saying they anticipate around 3 months. So I think it's just interesting. I don't know if we can talk to them and say, can you do this faster? Or I just thought that was an interesting, when they read the documents that we issued, that was their sort of guess on how much time it might take.
Lead investigator for Dave Pitney is Stanley Twardy, who says he's done a lot of investigations, and before entering private practice, he was U.S. Attorney for District of Connecticut, Chief of Staff to Connecticut Governor Lowell Leiker. He's the legal one, and they also mention former federal prosecutor Stephen Reynolds, and Associate Taylor Anderson. Dimensions there. And also associate the two of the attorneys. And then there's full bios, so just writing your names. Okay, schedule. 10 to 14 days to obtain background information. Start interviewing individuals. We expect we'll be able to conclude the investigation within a month, depending on the extent of involvement and availability of individuals. We presently expect, you know, 4 or 5 interviews, but it is possible, if not likely, that the number could expand based on what we learn. In total, the entire investigation should take 2 months, barring any unexpected circumstances. That includes drafting the report. Okay, so about 2 months. The other one was closer to 4 months. I don't think they provided a estimated total. The hourly rate for Daniel Twardy is $1,055. Stephen Reynolds is $805. The two attorneys were $130, and Taylor Anderson $405. I'm sorry, but then they have discounted rates: $791, $604, $323, and $304. So it's a 25% discount from their standard rates, which is still shocking to me, but that's just my inexperience with paying those type of rates. And the rest is resumes and I guess things they've written. And
I just usually go through and look for similar work representing municipalities. Have they written reports? Is there, you know, a town we could call? That's sort of the things I'm thinking about.
Yeah, we probably should check references.
Yeah.
So can I say something?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So just on those two, one consideration is: do you want a judge or do you want a prosecutor? So do you want somebody who's looked over things, or do you want somebody who knows how to investigate? Right? So that's one way of sussing through some of these proposals. Another thing is that the rates are the rates. I mean, and you have two major law firms. And I don't necessarily think that the town investigation, the town part of it, is the important piece. Really, the important piece is the subject matter.
I see what you mean. Right. I mean, whether they've worked for towns or not, as long as they've done similar investigations.
Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that's kind of the way to be thinking about how you're going to come to a conclusion about this, Is it about, what's it about? What do you want me to come to investigate? I mean, you gave them a list of subject matter, you gave them a list of concerns. But what do you want them to come back to having investigated?
Well, we did say that in the.
Yeah. So it's not about whether they know municipal law. Who cares? I mean, that's maybe part of it when they come back to it. But what's the subject matter that you want them to investigate?
Right.
Further comments on Dave Pittman?
I hear what you're saying, and I don't want you to think that I have tunnel vision. I just
my citizen's perspective.
It's useful. I'm glad you say that. But I do want you to know I'm not going to have tunnel vision. I just think that, you know, as part of the vetting process, this could take a long time just for us to, you know, figure this out. So I was just thinking of easy things that might be useful or easy things that might be. That might show us what the end result might be. But I think you're right. It doesn't have to be a town thing. It could be some other investigation. I think the rest is just cover letters. Resumes. Okay.
Recoverable disbursements. Not sure what that means.
They charge for disbursements or expenses incurred.
We did ask, what are we going to charge us other than hourly?
So they don't charge for, this looks.
They'll bill for mileage at the IRS rates. I think the one that got emailed said they don't charge for those type of things.
Mm-hmm. Again, it would depend on where these people are, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Is this charging for saving data?
Processing and hosting.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of detail. We're really going to have to look at this.
Mm-hmm. Pressing hosting, no charge if you're less than 5 gigabytes.
Food service?
Actual invoice.
All right. Well, it's good to know.
For something like that, there may be additional costs. All right. Spears, Manning, Martini. A shorter proposal.
Let me just go like this so we could.
Somebody said, I served as a federal prosecutor, whoever the person who signed the letter is, which is Brian Spears. Federal prosecutor district committee for 6 years. Investigations they've done since then. Several individual clients, sexual assault. Also, Joe Martini, a partner in the firm. He also was a federal prosecutor and has in the private sector. He's worked for Yale New Haven Health, Quinnipiac University, University of Haven, University of Hartford. Mentioned partner Leslie Cahill. Staffing plan. So the writer, we serve as lead attorney. Also, Leslie Cahill, a partner, and Janet Eastwood will be proposed to be used. Okay. The two partners rates, again, Steve, Brian Spears and Joe Martini, I think, is $650 an hour. Leslie and Jana, his rates are $500 and $425 per hour. Depending on volume of documents, it may be necessary to hire a vendor to host a searchable database. We have that kind of, I can imagine if you subpoena a corporation's documents, you get boxes and boxes, right? Have to be scanned.
I can't imagine that would be the case.
No, probably not. But they're probably not. We anticipate performing the bulk of the work within 2 to 3 months. We can accelerate the timeline as needed, provided we have access to information and witnesses, of course. And then they provide some references. To just put in contact ask. Okay, so that's the schedule, and can I look at anything else?
No.
The one that was emailed, Robinson and Cole, we looked at. Team would be led by Catherine Dion. Provides her her experience in litigation as well as investigations. Represented defendants in criminal cases.
She said that a significant portion of her practice has been conducting workplace investigations and counseling clients through investigations performed by others. That's interesting.
Education law, Title IX compliance, key assist child care centers and organizations serving youth and children responding to government investigations, conducting internal investigations, regulatory compliance, protection of minors, crisis counseling, development of policies and handbooks. Okay, so we're still talking about Catherine Dion. In addition to Kate Dion, additional team members will include associates Sabrina Gaffney and Teresa Lane. There are some references provided. All right, estimated time frame, 1 week for preparation, 2 weeks to collect documents and evidence, 1 month to conduct interviews. Obviously, could be extended outside of the circumstances outside of control, such as accommodating schedules of witnesses. If witnesses have engaged attorneys to accompany them during the interview. Analysis, 2 weeks, reporting, 1 week, and final report, 1 week. That adds up to two months. They won't provide an estimated total, but their billing rates are $530 for the partner, and Sabrina Galley, associate, is $370 an hour, Teresa Lane, $300 an hour.
It's interesting, at the very beginning of the proposal for Kate Dion, it says, in addition to her counseling and investigation experience, Kate has litigated over 20 cases in which claims were asserted against institutions for sexual misconduct involving staff and minors. I'm assuming she's representing the institution in this litigation. She has significant experience with laws and regulations concerning the protection of minors. And as part of those cases, she worked with experts who specialize in developing policies and procedures to protect minors in schools and youth organizations, and would bring this experience to her evaluation of what happened in Bethany. So there's no other fee schedule here.
No, some of them did not provide it. Well, actually, only one of them so far provided an estimated total cost. Other ones are just gave their rates.
Oh, it says a little bit here. We don't bill for routine expenses that we consider the cost of doing business, telephone, faxing, postage, word processing, travel.
and travel, right? Yeah, it's just included as overhead in those rates. Whereas I think the firm we just looked at before, but the bigger firm, Dave Pitney, had that whole schedule at the end, so they would, would charge for that stuff. All right, the Rice Hop, the Broadwood, Milford. Right, I have to see who signed it because he's using the first person, or she using the first person. T. Christopher Rice Hop. Been a licensed attorney for 30 years. I'm a career investigator. I've been served over 30 years in law enforcement, at local and federal level. Special agent, supervising special agent with the FBI. For 20 years, investigating a wide range of criminal cases, including directing investigations, preparing and evaluating case material for prosecution. Public corruption, civil rights, financial fraud, drug and murder. Okay. Portion of my tenure with the FBI has been as Associate Division Counsel in New York. Daily review of investigations, complaints with internal procedures. Maintain contact with the United States Attorney's Office. Supervisor of White Collar Investigation Program in the state of Connecticut. Field office management. In addition to serving with the FBI, I've employed as a local police officer in New York State for nearly 10 years. Investigated traffic offenses and accidents to burglaries, robberies, and other serious felonies. And interested in. Project we build at the rate of $200 per hour by the Rice Hop Law Group. We build on a monthly basis, detailing work performed and the hours expended. Estimated timeline between 90 and 120 days, but that timeline can be modified upon agreement of the parties.
What's the section here?
Terms and conditions, that maybe there's standard language. They're an independent contractor. They're not responsible for the town's actions. Assuming responsibility for ordinary expenses. Right, yeah, they're contractors. They have to pay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep, so that's it. This is also sole right to direct their own internal things.
Contractors.
Seems like we're looking at language. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Governed by the laws of the state of Connecticut. Enlisted references. State's attorney, FBI, judge, Superior Court judge. And then resume.
I think just, and then he said, I'll utilize others as needed.
Okay.
Yeah.
$200.
I'm glad we have, six to choose from because
I was worried it was going to be zero or maybe one.
I think some of them came in last minute and we had one that came in
last week.
So I'm grateful. I'm glad we have some to choose from, because if we only had the one, like, do you repost, do you delay, do you take the one? And so it's nice to have options.
We already talked about women commas and
I think, did we talk about anything?
Nope, we haven't done bribes. So here's the business guide. Tom Murray, Director of Investigations. Rosman Risk, I guess, is the name of the company. Well, did this, I know I said Pearl River. Oh, no, this is Denver, I guess, sorry. And they attached the proposal language or the letter of interest request. That's the letter they got from the attorney. This is the, just our information, attachment A. That was bad copy. All right, so here we are. Prepared by John Lyon, SVP, Investigation Senior Vice President, I guess.
Yeah.
That wasn't the name that was on there. So John Lyon, cover letter. Global headquarters is at 1 Blue Hill Plaza, Fall River, New York. Full service security and investigative firm serving global brands in all sectors. The largest privately held provider of technology-driven security services. Okay, 24/7 Global Security Operations Center. That's very fine print. all right, that's just the stuff that we provided them. Okay, John Ryan, an attorney and member of the bar, is this SVP. I assume that means Senior Vice President. Mm-hmm. Of investigations for Brosnan Risk, was formerly president and CEO of National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, held a nationwide initiative department with nonprofit and municipal agencies that ran youth-oriented programs, developed safety and compliance programs to prevent and respond to sexual abuse of children in their care, working with organizations such as the Boy Scouts of America, Boys and Girls Club, in Parks and Recreation in Baltimore and New York. Mr. Ryan developed model programs for youth-oriented programs for other agencies to implement. John will lead this investigation on behalf of the Town of Bethany if retained. In addition, three other people will be working on it. Mike Carroll previously was an executive with New York City Department of Investigations, has participated in numerous municipal-focused inquiries involving sexual assault and misconduct, particularly with a major school district within the state of Connecticut. Investigations included not only investigating specific allegations, also included extensive reviews of policies and procedures to identify gaps and vulnerabilities that might have contributed to the misconduct. For example, lack of training, insufficient background checks, poor interagency communication. Tom Murray, Director of Investigations, previously served is a sergeant with Connecticut State Police, has handled sex abuse cases, was acting commanding officer of the statewide organized crime investigation task force, who managed and supervised investigations funded by $500,000 grant, funding numerous sex trafficking investigations. All right, not really the same thing, right? Sex trafficking. Armando Rodriguez, vice president of investigations, former first grade detective in the New York Police Department, along with Tom Murray, will conduct both of interviews. They'll be examining the relevant laws, regulations, policies that should have been complied with based on the allegations. Final report. All right, what about? Okay, John Ryan, Michael Carroll, pictures. Rodriguez is, I guess, that's an investigator. References, anything about what they're going to charge? Okay. Hourly pricing, $275 an hour for investigator. Total budgeted price, $65,000, plus applicable taxes and fees. All right. Mileage will be billed at the prevailing IRS rate based on travel from headquarters.
Where's that?
New York.
Yeah.
Pearl, whatever, Pearl. To the assignment location, reasonable expenses such as tolls, parking, lodging, report printing, binding, and shipping costs. Anything about time? I don't see it. I don't want to go back to the room. They are saying $65,000, so they must have based that on something. I don't see anything.
Maybe we can look at it again more closely. I didn't see anything there either. I'm thinking it's more than 3 months, given the hourly rate. And
I think so.
I think so. I mean, it's a total, it's a guess. And we could ask them. I mean, we could you know, call them and ask them if they have an estimate.
All right, so I'm taking out the stuff that's not part of the proposal because it's just the stuff that they were sent. We don't need to reproduce that.
I don't know, maybe people want to see the letter.
Okay, we could also, yeah, we could say here's an example of the letter people got that they're invited and then the draft, the request.
I don't know if anyone noticed on the town website there was a problem with one of the attachments, and I think, did you know, I think you noticed?
Yeah.
And we fixed it as quickly as we could, but it was like an attachment, it was like 30 pages and only one or two pages were visible, and so we, you know, that was addressed as quickly as possible. So, I don't know, I think we need to review these copy, the ones that where we only have one copy, and
you kind of come up with,
yeah,
like a little spreadsheet or whatever, yeah, that to try to
let me ask you a question. Out of these six, are there any that you would knock out right away, or would do you want to do like a grid pros and cons for all of them?
That's a good thing. I don't know if any of them jumped out as no. I mean, the one that's different is Braz, and it's not, although there was an attorney.
Yeah, I think it was, yeah.
So it's, but I don't think any of them were a definite no at this point.
Yeah, I'd have to say that I agree. I think, you know, people took the time out to submit a response, and I'd like to go line by line and read what they submitted. And
yeah, of course, it's always difficult. I think they're all qualified, and it's going to be a question of reviewing and maybe seeing if there's some that are a little better fit for us. But mm-hmm. It's not like any, I don't think any are unqualified that could be ruled out right away.
Right.
So I guess there's no full copies of the Pullman and Conley, so we'll each take one home.
Right.
The other ones, unless we're going to try and copy them tonight, I suggest that they leave them with the town clerks and ask that they be scanned and get copies sent to us and also posted on the website.
I think that's a good idea. Yeah.
And then, I know there's a meeting, is it next week? The regular selectmen's meeting next week. We should at least have an item on there. Yeah, so hopefully we'll be done with
the review. I have to tell you, if you want to add this to the agenda, Paula is recused, and I will not continue if she's sitting at the table with us.
Yeah.
I just want to tell you that right now, because she has not handled the recusal well, and I just don't want to have any arguments over it.
What could be the last item?
That's a good idea.
Recuse or leave, yeah, or if she
that's
wanted
a good
to.
Idea.
I don't know what else is proposed on the agenda, so I don't know whether it's a long agenda. I would suggest we put it on the agenda for that night. If we're not ready to make a decision, we schedule, but maybe we will. I think it's going to be a hard decision.
Well, I think that it's a meeting that's in a week. We have this week to work on it. I will work on it. And I think that since it's a meeting that's already scheduled, we should take advantage of that and move forward. So I think that's a good idea. I mean, a million things could happen to make us not ready on Tuesday, but I think it's always the goal, right, to move forward in a way that's productive.
No, I'll have reviewed all of them. Yeah. I just don't know if when we're done, if there's going to be one obvious, this is the right one, or it's going to be, well, to talk about it, right? Because they're not really bad.
I mean, I don't know if you're interested, but I was thinking, like, how do you pick, right? If you have... When we were told that there were multiple proposals, how do you pick a proposal, right? It's not like, it's different than an interview for a job that, you know, this is something that affects other people, it affects the whole town, and I think we have an obligation to the town to make a good choice. I was thinking of continuing to do the work that we did today, which is taking out key aspects of what we're looking for, what's the time frame, what's the cost, and then other items that jump out at us that we think are maybe something that is said or some experience or whatever, or you talk to one of the references and it's a blown reference, whatever it is, the key points that make the applicant stronger, and then maybe something jumps out that is a concern. And I was going to rank them, you know, and just say, this is who I think I would choose. This is who I, if this one didn't work or became unavailable, this is who I would choose second. And if we kind of did that on our own, it would be interesting to kind of meet, right, to kind of see, you know, did we, I mean, it's really easy if our list is going to be the same.
Right.
You know, it would just be.
Yeah, it would have been easier if it was like, oh, this firm is really not. Right. It really did not come out, but it was really easy. How should we handle the references? Do you want to split them up?
You know,
because we're not allowed to talk about, you know, we can't communicate about doing it, or do we want town staff to call?
No, I don't want that. I don't want that. I think this is our, think this is work that we can't delegate. And I think delegating the work to someone that Paula supervises would be a violation of the status of her recusal. So I'm happy to make the calls, and you make the calls, and then if someone gets two calls, that's, you know, I just think, because I think splitting up names, I just think,
I was just trying to come up with a logical way to address that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so, sometimes, I don't know if you do this, like if they've provided a number of references, mm-hmm. I don't think it'll be the case here, but if I know the reference, then that's going to be my call, because they're more likely to give you a...
I thought you were going to say that's the one you wouldn't call.
No, I'm not talking about the contract or something. They're more likely to give you a honest answer,
right,
especially verbally versus in writing.
Absolutely.
Whereas people are always worried about litigation or something. So if it's in writing and it's somebody they don't know, they're going to be very they did complete the work.
I looked through really quickly. I didn't recognize any names.
Okay, so we'll just select some that we want to call, and if they get called more than once, we'll just apologize and say,
we're doing our due diligence.
Okay.
I think it's easier than sitting here for another hour, you know.
Picking, writing it up. And it may well be that some of the references we say, that's nice that they supplied it, but it's not really that relevant to what we need, so don't bother. Don't bother calling them.
So do you want to pursue getting this on the agenda for Tuesday? Is it Tuesday?
I believe it's next Tuesday.
Tuesday, at the last item on the agenda?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then that should take care of all the logistics about hybrid meetings and things like that.
Right. Okay.
And then if we're not ready to make a decision, we'll talk about it, and then we'll table the matter and schedule a special meeting. If we're ready to make a decision, then we'll select a firm and we'll work on the mechanics. What are the mechanics? Hypothetically, so we're going to go to Conway. And it's not a bid, we can't just award it. I guess we could select. And then the town would have to enter some kind of agreement with them. They're probably going to, the law firms at least, well, any of them, they're going to probably want a letter of agreement, right?
Some kind of contract.
They have to,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So we'd have to probably authorize someone to sign that. Maybe the finance director.
Why not you and I?
I think
it would be okay.
And then one thing that has to be obviously managed is the appropriation amount. They have to be made aware that they can't exceed that without prior written authorization.
Did we say somewhere? I think we said somewhere in here that. I don't think we did. No. So it's interesting. You know, the numbers are interesting given that, you know, we didn't tell them like this is your limit. You know, but did we say that some may be selected for an interview? Did we say that somewhere?
Yes.
Okay. So how do you feel? How do you feel about that?
I'm fine with it. It will add some time, I think. But
so yeah, I agree. So I think
that's probably. I mean, is it fair to drag six companies in? Some of them from other states.
Well, we could do it virtually,
sure.
But I think in terms of the time that it takes to do that, I would be okay with, you know, do the first level stuff, go through all the submissions in detail, and then see if there's a need.
Yes, and if we get to, I would think, Mark, we get down to like, okay, it's between firm one and firm two, and that'll be the deciding factor is talking to the right, investigator, exactly, yeah. The actual people who will be doing the investigation.
And then it would be two and not six.
Yeah, that seems a little more fair than, because mm-hmm. Because we're not going to pay them to do it. So to make five firms, you know,
right.
Put a lot of time and effort into what would be a low probability of getting the contract.
Sure.
Well, first of all, they may well ask for a retainer. So you'll have to be prepared for that. But you said you can't talk amongst yourselves except in public?
That's correct.
So we can talk about non-business things.
We can't talk about the investigation.
We can't communicate to talk about these proposals?
No, we cannot.
Because there's three people on the Board of Selectmen, two of them would be a majority, and that would be a quorum, so it would be like having an unofficial meeting if they don't do it publicly.
So,
not an efficient way to do things.
Well, you know what I think these rules are in place because traditionally meetings would happen in dark corners somewhere, and then there would be an announcement, and people didn't have the opportunity to know what was going on. So it is not the most efficient way to do things, but, you know, we can't.
But you're going to get to the meeting next Tuesday not knowing what each of
your rankings
are.
That's right.
And then you're going to have this kind of meeting yet again. So
yeah, that's right.
Maybe you need to call another special meeting so that you can.
But like before Tuesday?
Yeah. I mean, how are you going to know where you are?
Well, you know, what we should try to do is, as Connie said, I think the term rankings, we should force ourselves to say, if I were the only one selecting, I would pick this firm first, this firm
but
second.
But when, Tuesday or before Tuesday?
Before. I would say for Tuesday.
But she's saying before Tuesday.
How are you going to know who to interview if you wanted to interview? The top two, let's say, before Tuesday. You can't communicate. It doesn't make any
sense. We can, on our own, do the vetting. I can call people and I can say, hey, I have a question. This contradicts what you said on page two. I can do that sort of thing. I can call references. I can, do that sort of thing. But I can't say, hey, Bob, I really like number three. You want to go for it? You know, that's the sort of thing that is on the agenda and is part of what the town has a right to access. So we can't.
Unless you call a meeting. Right.
But, you know, I hear what you're saying, but what I'm thinking of is time, right? So I'm working all day and sometimes into the night. Right. And then, when am I going to do these calls? I mean, I have some flexibility at work, so I can do calls, you know, at noon or whatever. But if I'm taking the time to do a special meeting, I might jump into my time that I would normally use for this vetting. I don't know. I mean,
it's a dilemma that does.
Yeah, we might be able to do a Monday meeting. I don't think that really picks up too much time, though, versus Tuesday.
It is a dilemma. I just think that, you know, you're going to get there Tuesday and not have discussed this.
We definitely will not have discussed this for the next meeting, whether it's Tuesday or Friday or Thursday. Yeah. And when, you know, people get into all kinds of serious trouble when they break those rules.
No, I'm not saying you should break the rules. Oh, my God.
No, I'm not saying that that's what you're saying either.
I'm just asking for clarity, and is there a way that is there a way to address that in any sense so that you guys don't come back?
I don't think there is a way to address that in a way that would allow us to communicate, right? So, you know, sometimes people use these rules as an excuse to not have to talk to someone, right? I haven't done that. They are in place for a reason. And so we can't talk of anything of substance that's on the agenda and is potentially going to get a vote. So definitely not anything we've talked about today. We are not allowed to talk about that.
Weather, sports, kids, those are all.
So you're going to come to a meeting Tuesday with your, each of you having your
topic. Rankings, yeah.
Okay.
And if they line up?
If they line up.
And I suspect if my number one is her number two and her number two is my number one, it was have to make a decision, but
yeah.
I'm not married to any of these firms that, you know, I'd be like, absolutely, you don't go with this firm, I'm not right.
No.
So, I mean, I really think any of them are wrong. It's just finding the best one for us.
Yeah. So I thought that ranking idea might be a good idea. So is that?
Yeah. So okay. That's our homework, is to have them ranked.
I wish there was more we could say.
Yeah.
So, because you're pointing out that the way everything is structured is a barrier to our progress, and that's correct.
So interviewing anybody is going to be problematic unless you
interviewing anyone before Tuesday,
yes,
is probably impossible. It's impossible.
And it will have to be done like this at a public meeting.
Right, because for example, if I look at one of these in a lot of detail and I say, wow, this one really speaks to me, I want to interview them and just make sure that it's a good fit. I can't call Bob and say, I really like number whatever. Can we meet with them and see if we can button this up by Friday? Like, I can't do that.
Or can we both get on the Zoom?
No, definitely not. No.
This way, I mean, we don't, no. But people want us to get going as well.
I think you should get going. It's been going on forever.
We also want you to be able to thoroughly look at these folks and give them time to make sure they make a decision as opposed to demanding on Tuesday decision. Whereas on Tuesday, we come back and let you talk about whatever you've learned, because that's the only place that you can talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
And then maybe a week from that or whatever, you can set up another meeting where you give us the final decision.
Yeah, and I would encourage people, if you want copies, I'm happy to make copies tonight. If you find out something about someone that it really scares you, whatever, then send us emails. Let us know.
Who?
Huh?
You said we don't have your emails.
No, my email is not posted on the website, but anyway, you could email me. Yeah.
It's the Selectman, right?
Yes.
Selectman 2 and Selectman 3.
Definitely Selectman.
I'm trying to pronounce the A, not the E. It's Selectman.
It is, yeah. Selectman.
Yeah, Selectman 2 at Bethany-CT.
Bethany-CT.com.
Yeah, we had talked about, we would like to get those on.
So whatever the end is for the at Bethany, whatever, I'm Selectman 3, he's Selectman 2.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the email.
It's all set for the next people. They don't have to change the name. I understand that. And it's probably a good idea for our personal emails, because there's so many bots out there that get your email address and you get more ads and offers from princes in Saudi Arabia and stuff that are good to be true. Anything else you'd like to do tonight, Gina?
I just wanted to ask Themis if you have any objection to what I said about the recusal for Tuesday.
No.
Thank you.
Do you have anything to say on this, what you've heard tonight, Thomas?
No, I mean, I think that, you know, obviously you guys have to do your due diligence, and you'll do it individually, and because of the rules, you'll do it together next Tuesday, and for however long it takes to make the most responsible decision for the town. And I think that's where you're both going, it seems to me.
Thank you.
Yeah, most of the time, like a board of selectmen basically acts on stuff. The staff has done work, bids have been prepared by people, and the board kind of makes decisions. And that's really what we're better set up for than doing the work ourselves.
You need a raise.
Well, not that, but no.
That's real.
Okay. Shall we adjourn?
Sorry, because a couple of people have asked me about that.
Like, yeah, I would say we don't get paid, but there is a small stipend for this.
It is kind of funny. So if anyone's interested, I think Paul is 90-something thousand a year. Bob and I each get around $2,300 for the year.
It's more than
a lot of towns don't get paid anything.
Yeah.
No, select.
I mean, small towns.
Yeah.
The boards of selectmen, though, usually in most towns, in most small towns.
Yeah.
Well, then we're different.
I think it's probably been going back to the 1800s. They guys would get $10 for their service and just been increasing it with inflation. Would you like to adjourn?
Just if I could get a show of hands, is anyone interested in a copy tonight? Yeah, I just want to show hands because I'm offering it to people. I'll stand there. I want a copy for myself, so I'll make, you know, more copies.
Okay. Well, we're hoping there's no password or whatever.
Oh, I know.
So if it's feasible.
Well, no, because I want a copy tonight, so I want one for myself. I want a copy. So.
All right, then I might as well make one for myself as well.
Yeah.
But we'll have to go and see if we can run it.
Start reading it tomorrow. Now, the website, I think someone else in town will do that. Nick or someone?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I can't put it on the website.
Is that appropriate? They go on the website?
I think they're public now.
Oh, wait, no, website, sorry. Website, not the, I'm sorry. Website.
I mean, it's just like, you know, any communication with the town, it's public record.
Sorry, yeah, no, it's fine.
And luckily, they're all good proposals, so we don't have to worry about anyone being embarrassed or anything. Do you want to try the copy room?
Well, yeah, if we're going to do that, then yeah, we'll have to try to make copies.
So thanks everybody for coming. I think it's really great when people are interested in what's happening in town. And there were many meetings from like December to until we started talking about trash and recycling, where like nobody came at all. And it's I'm just glad that people are engaged.
Right, let's adjourn at 8:01.